Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Sand Trapped by Joanna Campbell Slan, narrated by Em Eldridge. Prologue. Crying I can handle. Emotional customers are not a rarity in the treasure chest, my store. They wander the section devoted to pet memorial items and sob over their dearly departed fur babies. That I can cope with. I hand customers a box of tissues and commiserate. I, too, have lost beloved pets, and I assume that's grief they are experiencing. However, Walter Beaton was not crying, nor was he teary-eyed and emotional. Nope, Walter was angry as all get out. He was ranting, raving, yelling, cursing, and generally being unpleasant. Walter was a little goblin of a man with a pot belly, watery blue eyes, and a thick mane of white hair. He also had a potty mouth. My, oh my, but Walter could have made a prostitute blush. In fact, he was tipping toward unhinged, and frankly, that scared me. Especially when Walter threatened to disembowel his veterinarian. Thankfully, the doctor wasn't our friend Pete Slatkin. Walter's lengthy explanation of all the tortures he had planned for the vet scared the pee wadden out of my customers. As he stood in the middle of my sales floor with spittle flying from his mouth, Walter began running off my customers. They walked backward toward the front door, never taking their eyes off of crazy Walter. Once they crossed the threshold onto the sidewalk, they took off running. I couldn't blame them. If I'd had the option of leaving, I would have raced off too. I didn't have the option of leaving. The treasure chest is my store, my bread and butter. And as such, it provides me with ongoing income by selling upcycled, recycled, and repurposed goods with a coastal vibe. Leaving Walter to fuss and fume would have been both cowardly and costly. So I gritted my teeth and tried to make soothing sounds. Unfortunately, it sounded like I was being strangled, and not like I was trying to calm the man down. Sigh, you can only do so much. Mr. Beaton, I am incredibly saddened by your news. I'm sure that your dog, And I paused because I couldn't remember the dog's name. Could it possibly be B.S.? Had I misunderstood? Walter's disjointed commentary had been hard to follow.
B.S., Beaton supplied. Stands for Beaton's Sugarland, an AKC champion Shih Tzu. He was best in show at the Westminster Kennel Club dog show 2 years ago.
As a proud owner of rescue pups, that didn't mean diddly squat to me. Obviously, it did to Walter Beaton, so I said, I'm sure your dog, B.S., was a wonderful pet. The words were out of my mouth when I wondered if anyone had given those unfortunate initials, B.S., a second thought.
If you mean like a cuddly companion or a four-legged best friend, you are barking up the wrong tree!
Beaton yelled so loudly that the antique china shivered in its display case. Okay, I said, wondering if he realized the pun he'd made. What did Walter Beaton mean when he said his fur baby wasn't a cuddly companion or a four-legged best friend? Confusion sent my head spinning. I tried once again to offer my condolences. I am deeply sorry for your loss. As a pet lover myself, I know how painful. I didn't get any further because Walter slammed his fist down against the top of my cash wrap station. The force of his anger caused bracelets, anklets, necklaces, and charms to jump from their spots on the display carousel. Admittedly, my heart did a flutter step too. Flecks of Walter's spit were landing on my skin each time he opened his mouth.
Painful? I'll show you painful.
His hand went to his back pocket, and he withdrew a business card that he tossed across the counter at me. On the front was a photo of a white Shih Tzu standing proudly under a blue banner that read, AKC Champion, Stud Beaton's Sugarland Empress, out of Snowball's Fancy. I picked up the card and studied it. I know nothing about the Shih Tzu breed, but I could see how the animal in the photo resembled those ceramic foo dogs I've seen at Pier 1. Walter grabbed the card out of my hand and waved it at me in a menacing way.
See? B.S. was a champion stud, and he'd already produced $50,000 worth of...
And he glanced around at the female customers who were staring at him before finishing.
Puppy juice.
Walter's face reddened as he jammed the card into his back pocket. It's certainly a tragedy, I agreed, while moving to the far end of the cash wrap station. With any luck, I could get Walter to join me, so the two ladies couldn't overhear his complaints. I offered this. Any pet lover would commiserate with you over the loss of companionship. Throwing back his head and hooting, Walter said,
Companionship? Ha ha, that's rich. That dog's not my companion. He wasn't even my friend. Do you know that if I got up in the middle of the night to use the John, I had to call Selena on her cell phone and get her to grab hold of him before I climbed back into bed? 100% true. Otherwise, Sugarland would bite me. Hard. See the scars?
He pulled up a sleeve to show me a series of white crescent marks running up his forearm. No doubt about it, this man had been bitten repeatedly.
You thought I was kidding, didn't you? I am not. That little monster was vicious. Don't get me wrong, B.S. loved my wife, but that dog only tolerated me. And I tolerated him because he made me a bundle of do-re-mi, money, cash in my bank account. As a stud, that little squirt cannot be beat. Introduce him to a female dog in heat, and he would get busy like...
The doorminder rang and two customers walked in. My attention shifted as I worried about how to keep them engaged in shopping, despite Walter's off-color ranting. Suddenly, I remembered a trick I'd learned from my old pal, Kiki Lowenstein. Walter, I could use a bottle of cold water from the back. Can I get a bottle for you, Pitching my voice louder, I addressed the two new guests. Ladies, how about you? A nice cold bottle of water? On the house? The women twittered like a pair of blue jays. They nodded, but when I turned back to Walter, before hightailing it to the back, he crooked a finger at me. I leaned closer and he whispered,
You wouldn't happen to have anything stronger, would you?
I shook my head at him. Belatedly, I added, Coffee? It's from Caldi's, and it's really, really good. With a sigh, he mumbled,
Water and coffee are all you can offer me at a time like this? All right, bring me the water, as long as it's cold.
I excused myself and escaped to my back room. There, Honora McAfee, my oldest employee, stood with her eyes wide, her mouth hanging open, and her hands clutching at her faux pearl necklace. Sugarland is dead? My stars! No wonder Walter is fixing to give birth to a three-headed cow. The visual imagery stopped me in my tracks. Excuse me? A three-headed cow? Slowly, she took her hands down from her necklace and folded them in a pious attitude of prayer. Her lightly tanned skin contrasted with the pink and white stripes of her seersucker shirt dress. No wonder Walter is beside himself. Lord above, how that man bragged about his dog. Every time that pooch won a dog show, Walter would buttonhole strangers on the street to tell them he owned a prize stud. Cupping a hand around her mouth, she lowered her voice. That was unnecessary because we were in my back room, but Honora did it anyway. I've always wondered if he was proud about that dog's ability to breed because he was, you know. I didn't know, but I could imagine, and I didn't want to hear any more about it. In fact, there was this strong urge to stick my fingers in my ears and sing, La 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 la. But I didn't. Instead, I walked to the refrigerator to grab the bottled water. As I did, I tried to direct our conversation to a side road, a detour, if you will. no matter whether the dog was fertile or not, I feel awful about Walter's loss. I know how I felt when I lost my dog 2 years ago. Stepping past Honora, I grabbed 4 bottles of water and headed for the sales floor. I bawled for days. At the drop of a leash, I would suddenly think about Sven and boom, tears would stream from my eyes. I was a real mess. Walter would never cry about BS, but as you've heard, he is absolutely livid. That dog was an investment. Did I hear it right? I just caught bits and pieces. Did the dog really die while on Walter's watch? Honora asked, but she didn't wait for me to answer. I nodded. He says BS was bitten by a coral snake. Can you imagine? That's horrible. Beautiful and deadly, the coral snake was as bold as it was venomous. Most snakes race away from you, but a coral snake will stand its ground and strike. Adding to its treachery, the snake's fangs are so sharp and the strike is so swift that many victims don't even realize they've been struck. Walter is angry at his vet, not the snake, I explained to Honora. He's convinced the vet could have administered an anti-venom and saved the dog's life. That's wrong, said Honora, closing her eyes and shaking her head. The anti-venom for a coral snake bite is almost as deadly as the bite itself. And that's when they bite a person. Striking a dog? There would be much more toxin in a smaller mass. So of course the bite would be fatal. Walter is being ridiculous. I shrugged. I guess. I didn't know that about the coral snake's bite. I presumed that in this day and age, there was an anti-venom for just about any entanglement. Not really, Honora continued. Certainly not in this case. There goes the beaten's marriage. Walter and his wife Serena have been at each other's throats for years. She was telling everybody at bridge last week that she hoped he'd keel over from a heart attack. Now this, who knows what she'll do to get rid of him? I juggled the bottles of cold water. My hands were hurting from the frigid plastic. Come on, Honora, that's ridiculous. Killing your spouse because your dog died by accident? To you and me, it is unreasonable, but not to Selena. Honora took a shaky breath before adding, she made no secret of the fact that she vastly preferred Sugarland to Walter, and he knows it. Now that the dog is dead, Walter might find himself out on the streets and carrying his belongings in a black plastic garbage bag. They're living off of her family money, after all. Now scat and take him that water. Maybe you can get him to cool down, although I doubt it. Back on the sales floor, I offered the cold bottle of water to my lady visitors and then to Walter Beaton. He drank the contents down quickly.
This all you've got?
I thought he'd gone back to questions about my liquor cabinet. But no, he was gesturing at our selection of pet memorial items. A picture frame with paw prints, a generic photo album that could have the pet's name added, a charm that could be inscribed, and a small plaque with a sentiment about all pets going to heaven. If you're asking if these are all the pet memorial items we carry, the answer is yes, I said. Trying to see the selection through his eyes, I realized how paltry the offerings were. When people lost a pet, they experienced powerful emotions. We needed to stock merchandise that allowed them to vent those feelings.
Huh,
he said as he shoved his empty water bottle at me.
And I heard you were a savvy marketer. You don't know anything about losing a pet, lady.
I stood there dumbfounded. That wasn't true at all. But I knew better than to argue with a grieving customer. I'm sorry we disappointed you, Mr. Beaton, was the best I could do. After he left, I sent a text message to all of my employees. We need to expand our pet memorial section. Any and all ideas are welcome. Chapter 1. That incident with Walter Beaton was a lesson for me. Never make an assumption about how other people feel. Here, I'd thought he would be heartbroken, but he wasn't. He was furious. Walter's desire to memorialize Sugarland came from a deep concern that his wife was going to clobber him. Not from a place of grief. Nevertheless, his reaction to our pitiful selection of pet memory items shifted me into high gear. I immediately collected the best, brightest, and most innovative ideas my staff could render. Thanks to Walter's visit, we now had a huge collection of pet merchandise, covering all different price points. The sales had been a nice add-on business, as word of mouth quickly brought more and more clients to our store. With that as a backdrop, I should have been prepared, but the week had just begun, and Mondays are typically slow. All of that changed when a sobbing Mimi Winkler came barreling into the treasure chest. Clutched to Mimi's bosom was a cream-colored urn, a type I'd seen before, and I could guess the nature of Mimi's distress. Dead pet walking. "I am so sorry," I said. Over the past month, I'd learned I couldn't go wrong by leading off with those words. Repeating them over and over was the best way to handle a grief-stricken customer. Even angry customers like Walter Beaton would respond positively to that phrase, "I am so sorry."
"Thank you. You're so kind. Sabbath is dead," Mimi said as she stood in the middle of the sales floor and sobbed.
Being the intelligent woman I am, I knew immediately that she had not put an end to the Sabbath day, otherwise known as Sunday for Christians and Friday for Jews. No, she could not have done that. However, someone or something named Sabbath had died, and since Mimi was carrying a funerary urn, I had a reason to think it might be a pet. Yes, that made sense.
"I am so sorry," I repeated. There was very little you could do to comfort a pet owner after a loss. "He was such a beautiful cat, a real tough guy. I never neutered him, you know. I loved his independent spirit, his swagger. And I curse the person who poisoned him."
This last bit she said in a scream of anger. "Poisoned him? When in doubt, repeat what the other person says, especially if that person is upset. You can't go wrong mirroring their words back to them."
"Someone poisoned your cat?"
"Yes, that must have been what happened. I found him at the very back of my lot, where it borders the golf course. He was out in the open, lying on his side. I knew immediately that he was dead. Looking at him was too horrible. I couldn't stand it, so I went back into the house and grabbed a pillowcase to wrap him in. Then I took his poor, stiff body directly to Treasured Pet's veterinary clinic. I had him cremated."
Mimi choked up. I grabbed one of the boxes of tissues we keep near the fur baby display and handed it to the woman.
"As you probably know, my house backs up to the sixth tee at Sandy Ridge Country Club. It's that spot where there's a sand trap that all of the local golfers hate and try to avoid."
This is the sort of snobbery that gets my goat and makes me wish I had a goat rather than a retail store. Mimi Winkler's grandiose assumption that, of course, I knew her house was located by hole 6 at Sandy Ridge. Why would I know that? Why would I care? Sheesh. There were times when I despaired of living here on the Treasure Coast, where people were obsessed with gloating about their property. The sad truth was more complicated. Although I did not know that her house backed up to the sixth hole of Sandy Ridge, I was acquainted with that hole. It is famous because of the bunker, the trees, and the sand trap. A triple threat, for sure, and one that was well known for challenging golfers of all skill levels, even pros. Numerous times, that hole has been featured on sports shows, as experts have used it as an example of a particularly challenging play to make. It's a real headache for golfers like me who don't play daily or even several times a week.
Back in high school, I'd been on the golf team. I grew up in St. Louis, and that whole city is mad crazy nuts for golf. We fielded competitive high school golf teams for decades. So being on the golf team was pretty much a given, and not a mark of special talents. After marrying and having my son, Tommy, I'd quit playing. For the most part, at least. Once in a while, I'd go out with my dad.
"You have the prettiest swing, darling daughter," my father would say. "That's what comes from taking golf at such an early age."
After my parents died and I moved here, Florida is the golf capital of the world. I hadn't touched my clubs in years. But one sunny afternoon, my next-door neighbor, Aurora Hamilton, popped over and asked if I'd like to go hit some balls with her over at Sandy Ridge. She was working on her short game, because Aurora is a keen golfer. She's won the club championship and a member guest, and she intends to keep on winning tournaments.
"Come on, Cara," Aurora said. "It'll do you good to get out. You spend too much time in your store. A break will help you think. You always need new ideas. Being out in the sunshine and fresh air will do that for you."
"All right," I said, "if you insist. But be forewarned, I'm pretty rusty. I haven't picked up a golf club in years." Aurora didn't care. When we got out to the putting range, she was impressed by my swing.
"You have a beautiful swing. Great follow-through. You get a lot of spin on the ball. Lucky you," Aurora said.
A shiver crawled up my spine. It was like my dad came up behind me and whispered,
"Told you,"
in my ear. Dad believed that getting proper instruction early kept you from developing bad habits. According to my subsequent coaches, Dad had been right. Sure, there were days when I couldn't hit a ball straight to save my life, but in every case, my swing needed tweaking, not total revision. The basics had been firmly ingrained in me. "I'm really out of practice," I said. "But thank you, Aurora. Coming from you, that's high praise." Mentally, I added, "Thanks, Dad." From then on, Aurora and I played the links at Sandy Ridge fairly often. I wasn't ready to cough up the big bucks for a membership, but I could pay my own way as Aurora's guest. Of course, she played at the club between our outings, but for me, once every 7 days was the maximum time I could take away from work.
"You have played the Sandy Ridge Golf Club?" asked Mimi, dragging me back to the here and now.
Her cocked eyebrow suggested that a poor, starving merchant like myself couldn't afford to play the club.
"You aren't a member there.
I know everyone who is."
"Yes, I've played it. No, I'm not a member. It is a beautiful course. How lucky for you to live there." I kept my tone even. As nice as Sandy Ridge Golf Club was, and it was nice, it didn't hold a candle to living on Jupiter Island, like I do. But Mimi didn't need to know that. My personal life was none of her business.
"I always thought I was fortunate to live on the outskirts of the club, until this happened. My poor, poor cat. Sabbath must have died a horrible, painful death. I feel so sorry for him."
Her beautifully manicured fingertips stroked the urn. I was studying the ceramic vessel intently, so Mimi held it up for my inspection. The lid was of particular interest to me because it was embossed with the logo from Pete Slatkin's vet clinic, Treasured Pets. Pete is engaged to marry one of my friends and employees, MJ Austin. I'm glad they are getting hitched for many reasons, not the least of which is that he gives me a friends and family discount on vet services. "That urn is lovely. Your pet is in there? That's so sad to think that someone would poison your cat. There is a special hell for people who hurt animals," I said. "I've always thought as much."
"I agree. And I called the Stewart Police Department about the poisoning, but I don't think they're going to do a thing. Not one blasted thing. Do you know, Cara, that people who harm animals are more likely to harm people? It's a continuum. And children who harm animals and wet the bed and set fires often become serial killers? Mimi was on a roll. I wasn't sure about the validity of the facts she was quoting, but that didn't matter. Not really. Her heart was aching, and with good reason. If it was true that her cat had been poisoned, he would have met a sad ending. Not at all like the gentle crossing to the other side that we pet owners can give an elderly or sick pet with euthanasia. No, poison practically guaranteed a painful end of life. Someone had wanted Sabbath to suffer. Mimi, I'm sure you're here because you've heard how we have a new section in the store. We have an entire display of ways to memorialize your pet. May I show you what we have? For goodness sakes, I sounded like a California Valley girl with all those questions at the end of my sentences. But there was a reason for my odd speaking voice. I know full well that those who are in mourning can be unpredictable with their emotions. Last week, we'd had a grieving owner of a golden retriever who'd literally lost his stuff here in the store and smashed several handmade pieces of pottery.
"My best friend is gone,"
the man had howled. As a longtime pet owner, I understood the depths of his pain, but I wasn't nearly so compassionate about the damage he'd done. "Look at the bright side," said MJ Austin, one of my full-time employees and a real expert in all things Floridian. "Those hand-thrown vases weren't selling anyway. They were overpriced and ugly. Now you're rid of them." "Yeah," I grumbled as I swept up the mess. "But we'll be finding shards all over the floor for the next month, in every nook and cranny. You know how that goes. When you break something that's cylindrical, the pieces fly all over. I hate that, especially as we go into summer and more of our customers are wearing sandals." With that nasty incident in my mind, I treated Mimi with extreme care, the entrepreneurial equivalent of kid gloves. Taking her by the arm, I walked her over to the dead pets display, aka the Rainbow Bridge, which I was particularly proud of. We'd included pre-made memory albums, nose and paw print memorabilia, specialty photo frames, necklaces that could hold small amounts of ashes, grave markers, tote bags with windows for photos, and so on. People went nuts over the new additions, and I was pleased by the surge in sales. Mimi immediately grabbed up several items. She loved the memory album, a garden marker, a tote bag, and a photo frame that we could have personalized. She also wanted the personalized pet gravestone so she could bury the urn and mark the spot. "Do you happen to have a photo of your cat? Maybe even more than one?" I was wrapping her purchases in tissue paper as I rang them up. "Thank goodness I do." Mimi stuck her phone in my face and with one finger flicked through a series of pics of a solid black cat. "That's great, because we have a skilled felt needling artist who can make a replica of your pet," I said, as I pulled out the color brochure. "Either full-sized, half-sized, or 1 inch to a foot. Your choice." Most people immediately flipped to the page with the prices and went into shock, but Mimi did not. Instead, she grew misty-eyed as she pored over photos of other memorialized pets that looked, frankly, totally realistic. Short of taking your dead fur baby to a taxidermist, this was a super way to pretend the animal was still alive and kicking. Okay, maybe not kicking, but pretty darn close.
"I want one. I want a full-sized version of Sabbath," whined Mimi.
"Let's fill out the form together, shall we?" This was a smooth move on my part, because by filling out the form, I could collect the money right away. I also circled the disclaimer that once the animal was created, no refunds would be issued. A felted creature like this takes hundreds of hours and many, many hanks of wool, so we simply can't offer refunds. "I hope you'll understand," I explained.
Absolutely, said Mimi, as she handed over her black American Express card. The final total on the black card was enough to put my store in the black for another month. If you'd like the gravestone personalized, and your initials or Sabbath's name on the photo album, we can do that as well. We can also have his image added to one of our canvas bags. I want all of that, Mimi said, grabbing a pen so she could indicate exactly what she wanted. When she finished, I thanked Mimi for her business while sharing my deepest condolences. Once she walked out the door, I could write out a condolences card and mail it to her, as a reminder of how much we cared, along with a coupon for 25% off any future purchase. Chapter 2. Looking back, that visit from Mimi Winkler was a harbinger of things to come. At the time, I couldn't have guessed she was bringing me and my shop so much bad luck. That's the way things go, I guess. I closed the store at 5 and mentally filed away her visit. By the time I made it home to take care of my own fur babies, I'd forgotten all about Mimi. Since I often work long hours, I've contracted with a pet sitting service, TLC Pets. The owners are Trisha Connor and Pat Davis. Trisha and Pat have a small army of pet walkers on hand, ready to be dispatched at a moment's notice. That comes in particularly handy when I have a last-minute snag that keeps me away from home. I knew the fur kids had gone out recently and had treats, but they acted like they were starving when I hit the front door of my little cottage on Jupiter Island. Gerard, my Royal Bahamian potcake, jumped up and down and yodeled with joy at seeing me. Jack, the chihuahua I'd rescued when he was tossed out of a moving truck, ran around in tight circles and yipped. Even Luna, the cat I'd adopted after her owner died, joined the fray. Luna has a particularly ear-piercing yowl. Although Luna is an even shade of gray all over, she must have some Siamese in her, Pete says. She's certainly the noisiest cat I've ever met. In particular, Luna can be a real pest at mealtime. Even if she still has kibble in her dish, she knows her rights, and by golly, come 5:30, she expects a top-up on the fancy feast or else. I fed and watered all of my four-footed roommates, changed my clothes, heated up a chunk of frozen lasagna, and fixed a salad. After I ate, the kids and I cuddled on the sofa while I watched a documentary on the Challenger disaster. As usual, when I crawled into bed, I had to fight for room because all the fur kids wanted to sleep right on top of me. Briefly, I thought about poor, dead Sabbath. As I drifted off to Luna's loud purring, I felt sorry for Mimi Winkler. Losing Sabbath had clearly affected the woman deeply. And losing a pet to poison? My stomach churned thinking about it. Poor, poor Sabbath. The next morning, I was sitting at my dining room table. Although I don't have a designated dining room, I still think of that area as such. And scrolling through news on my iPad, when the crunch of tires on my gravel driveway announced a visitor. Gerard immediately barked as if our lives depended on him sending out a warning signal. Jack joined in, and Luna ran and hid under my bed. The rapping on my screen door that followed came as no surprise, given the alarm my dogs had raised. Nevertheless, I was a little shocked to see my neighbor, Dr. Aurora Hamilton, standing there in full golf gear. Today, she had a big grin on her face, but that wasn't surprising. Aurora is always happy, without fail happy, and she's the most cheerful person I know. She and her husband, Bill, live in the honking big mansion to the south of my house. As a matter of fact, my cottage was once the caretaker's house for the building that was originally on their land. They knocked down that old house and built a stunning palace that looks like Addison Meisner built it. The first time I saw the Hamilton's mansion, and it really is a mansion given the number of rooms it has, I thought to myself, this woman and I have absolutely nothing in common. We'll never get along. I was dead wrong. Aurora's the most down-to-earth person I know. She loves animals, she has a heart of gold, and she's a terrific friend. This morning, she was an unexpected visitor on my front porch, and I wondered what had caused this turn of events. Aurora talks a mile a minute, and I knew she would quickly get me up to speed. "Get dressed," she said, tapping her foot impatiently. "Excuse me?" "I need you," she said, and she pushed past me into the house. Aurora's 5'4" and weighs maybe 100 pounds. She wears her long auburn hair up in a scrunchie unless she's going out. Today, it was caught up with a leopard print scrunchie, and the ponytail stuck out of the back of her hot pink Sandy Ridge Golf Club baseball cap. A matching hot pink golf shirt with a floral hot pink, coral, grass green, and white print golf skirt completed her outfit, except for the clogs. She always wears black clogs with pink flowers so she can walk the beach and not get sand in her shoes. Immediately, I realized her golf shoes must be in her car. She said, "We have to hurry." My initial thought was that I'd made a golf date with her and forgotten. But as I closed the door in her wake, I tried, and failed, to remember any such appointment. "Aurora, help me out here. I just woke up. What am I missing? Where am I supposed to be? Did I make a date with you?" "No," she said quickly. Aurora was walking in tight circles in my living room. She reminded me of a race walker, the way she moved with such urgency. "Kay Rogers was supposed to be my guest for the member guest tournament, and she canceled." "Just like that? Can you believe it? Called me up this morning and said she couldn't come. Has a hangnail or some equally silly problem. I tried to talk her into playing, you bet I did. This is so last minute and totally rude. Now I'm in a pickle. I need a partner or I forfeit. I cannot forfeit. You aren't a member, so you would qualify as a guest. You know the course. I need you to come and play with me." "But I wanted to say I had other plans. My library books were stacked on my bedside table. My grocery list was in my purse. My laundry was sorted by colors. I had the day off, and I'd decided how I wanted to use my time. But Aurora's my friend, and my neighbor. And the day was already shaping up to be glorious, with a beautiful blue sky and a mild temp. Low humidity, no wind, a perfect day for golf." "Please," Aurora stared at me. "I'm in a real bind. I could call Andrea, but she's got her appointment today with her chiropractor. Elise is watching her grandchild. Connie broke her little toe and can't stand up for more than 20 minutes. You're my only hope, Obi-Wan Kenobi." She threw in that last line so I would giggle, and I did. Still, we both knew I was not her best choice, and I said as much. "Aurora, I'm not that good. You know I've been away from the game for too long, and I don't play that often. I'm not up to snuff." "But you have a handicap of 18, and that's respectable. You've played that course, so you know it. It won't throw any surprises your way. And," she did a tiny drum roll on my table with her palms, "it's best ball. Cara, you don't need to be good. All you need is to be there so I have a partner. You can hit the ball wherever you want, long or short, and I'll play to win." She was right. As long as Aurora had a warm body tagging along while she played, she could win the match. The pleading look in her eyes said more than what her words conveyed. Aurora is fiercely independent. She's a giver, not a taker. For her to ask me to do anything was unusual. For her to need help was unheard of. Yet here she was, rocking from one leg to the other nervously. So what else could I say but, "I'll need to get dressed." "I'll help," she said. As I picked up my coffee cup and walked it back into my kitchen, the whirling dervish I call my friend tore through my closet and my drawers. By the time I walked back into my bedroom, she'd gotten out a coral golf skirt with green palm leaves and a white golf shirt. See? She asked. All you need to do is put all of this on. You don't need help with that, do you? Okay, good. Glad to hear it. I'll take Gerard and Jack outside to do big poopies. They haven't gone yet, have they? Oh, and I'll call your dog sitter and see that he comes by. We shouldn't be gone long, but you never know. With that, she closed the bedroom door behind her. As I dressed, her voice floated back to me as she wandered around my yard with the dogs. Aurora coaxed and cajoled Gerard to do his business, and Jack not to wander off. I brushed my teeth, ran a brush through my curls, and following Aurora's lead, I used a scrunchie to gather up that wild bush that I call hair. Next, I applied a slathering of sunblock, a spritz of bug spray, and I clamped a pink St. Louis Cardinals baseball cap on my head. I was walking out of my bedroom as she and the dogs were coming in. My shoes and clubs are in my car, I said. Good, said Aurora. We'll grab them and away we'll go. I always like to arrive at least an hour before the starting gun goes off. That was understandable. By getting to the course early, Aurora and I would have the chance to settle our nerves, check in, get our player numbers, and go potty. Racing up at the last minute would make it much, much harder to play our best games. I opened the garage door, hoisted my clubs, and carried them to the hatchback of Aurora's Tesla. Once they were snuggled next to her bag, I raced to my car and grabbed my golf shoes from the trunk. Next thing I knew, we were buzzing north on A1A and heading toward Sandy Ridge Golf Club. Watch your speed, I warned Aurora. She's had 2 tickets in the past 6 months. Both times, she was in a hurry, and she lost track of the speedometer. If we get pulled over, we'll lose time, I said. Okay, okay. Aurora Leadfoot eased off the gas pedal. Except on a Tesla, it's not the gas pedal, is it? It's the accelerator, I think. I'll have to look that up. She couldn't play because of a hangnail? I asked, as I reviewed the sequence of events that had ended with me sitting in the passenger seat. Apparently not. Aurora lifted a hand and let her fingers flutter. That's pretty weak. I know. And she knows how much this tournament means to me. I won it last year, and I intend to win it again. Is it possible she's backed out on purpose? I knew from talking to Aurora that some of the women in the club were, to put it nicely, snarky and sneaky. A few of them had nothing better to do than stab one another in the back repeatedly. They could be nice as pie to your face, and then totally cutthroat when it came to their golf game. If I was honest, that was one of the reasons I hadn't wanted to play today. I've never been good at politics. I've never been able to hold my tongue when someone irks me. How Aurora put up with some of the backbiting was beyond me. Once, when I asked her, she smiled sweetly and said, "Because I win. I can put up with it because I get to take home the trophy at the end of the day. They don't." "I wouldn't put anything past Kay Rogers," said Aurora. "She's a nice enough woman, but she doesn't have anything to do with me, except when she needs a golf partner." "That's weird." "Isn't it? I don't get it. Why not be nice all the time? What's there to lose?" Aurora shook her head. "Kay has everything a person could want. Her health, a ton of free time, and a husband who indulges her." "Put that way, she should be on top of the world," I agreed before I shrugged. Who knows what evil lurks in her pea brain? That got Aurora laughing. Chapter 3. Aurora turned north on A1A and expertly passed slower traffic. Her white Tesla makes no noise at all, which can be mildly disconcerting at first. Until you ride in a Tesla, you don't realize how much the sound of a motor is part of the automotive experience. Certainly, you can carry on a conversation easily when you're riding in a Tesla, because there's no talking over the sound of the gear shifting. "How's business?" Aurora asked. I told her about the new pet funerary section. She knew we were planning to install it, but we hadn't talked since the display went in. As a matter of fact, yesterday, I waited on one of your fellow club members, Mimi Winkler. Someone evidently poisoned her cat, Sabbath. I know why, said Aurora in a very offhand way. What do you mean? This caught my attention. Aurora is an animal lover, and her voice held a hint of irritation. Sadness I'd expected, but being irked came as a surprise to me. Mimi refused to have her cat neutered, and she wouldn't keep him indoors. Since she lives right next to the sixth hole, golfers were always having to play around her cat. Worst of all, that cat used the sand trap as his own personal litter box. Imagine this. You're trying to find your ball in the sand, and instead you dig up a clump of cat poop. Phew. I had an involuntary reaction. Yes, I remember playing that hole and watching a big hunk of cat poopies flying when another golfer hit his ball out of the trap. People begged and begged Mimi to keep the cat indoors, but she had this romantic notion that he was a free spirit. Except now he's a dead free spirit. Aurora continued, I remember having to play around that cat because he was napping in the sand trap and wouldn't move. He was a pill. Beautiful, sleek, and black as a lump of coal with brilliant green eyes. But because Mimi refused to take control of him, everyone hated that poor cat. Turning off of A1A, Aurora pulled up to the guard gate. An elderly black gentleman slowly stood up and came over to slide his door open. Hi, Palmer, Aurora chirped. How are you today?
I'm fair to middling, Miss Aurora. Are you fixing to play in that tournament today?
Yes, I am. So's my friend, Cara. Her name should be on the list, Cara Mia Delgatto. Palmer slowly rotated and grabbed a clipboard. After running a finger down the column, he squinted over at me.
You're Dick Potter's grandbaby, aren't you?
Yes, I am. I gave the guard a friendly wave of acknowledgement.
Sure enough, you are, said the guard.
His face split in two as he grinned broadly. While handing Aurora a purple card to stick in her window, he never took his eyes off of me.
You're the spit of your grandmother. Good seeing you. Tell Dick I said hi.
I will do that, sir. Aurora took the access road that wound around the Sandy Ridge golf course. The ride should have been relaxing, but she slammed on the brakes at a golf cart crossing sign that indicated the carts would drive across the road. The cart was green and white, and the woman driving it paid no attention at all to the fact she was holding up traffic. Instead, she hunkered down in the driver's seat and floored the tiny vehicle. Rocks and dirt flew up behind her. One of these days, someone is going to hit JJ with a car, muttered Aurora. Who is JJ? I asked as I watched the back of the cart race away from us. Jocelyn Johnson, an absolute terror on wheels. She lives here on the course. I think her house is close to Mimi Winkler's, because I've heard Mimi complain about JJ. All I know is that she drives her golf cart all around the grounds and the streets that border the club. And she drives like a maniac. The police have warned her, ticketed her, fined her, and taken away the driver's license for her to operate an automobile. Then what's she doing racing around? Aurora sighed. Her husband Eugene has heart problems, and they claim that JJ needs the golf cart in case she has to go and get help for Jean. Of course, I doubt that will ever happen. Why not just call 911? But Eugene and JJ have convinced the club's board of directors that the cart is necessary, so the rest of us have to put up with her shenanigans. Do you know that she nearly hit me while I was standing on the side of the road, searching for one of my golf balls? It's true. I looked up at the last minute and basically dove into a clump of bushes. I was so angry that I phoned JJ to complain when I got home. What did she say? She laughed and said, "But I didn't hit you, did I? You worry too much, Aurora." And then she hung up on me. I didn't talk to her for a week. Bill was so angry that he wanted to call, but I persuaded him not to. What good would it do? I agreed with her. On the other hand, maybe she should have called the Stewart police. Even though the incident occurred on private property, the Ring Road was surely funded by the city. Or was it? Come on, and I'll introduce you to a few of our competitors. Aurora waved for me to follow her.
Ah, I see you found a guest to play with. That is good, said a strongly built woman with bright blonde hair.
After introducing herself as Gerta Hunsickler, the player politely asked my name and how I knew Aurora. Once those preliminaries were out of the way, Gerta turned her attention to Aurora.
So I was thinking you might have to forfeit, eh? But no such luck for the rest of us.
That's right, Gerta. If you want the trophy, you'll need to win it from me. Although Aurora was 8 inches shorter than Gerta, she didn't flinch as the woman took an intimidating stance. Gerta was playing mind games, and all three of us knew it. My high school coach frequently lectured us on what a mental game golf is. More than most other sports, the game messes with your thinking. In basketball or football, you are practically forced to leave your negativity behind. Your teammates will keep playing their positions, and you'll get caught up in the swirl of activity. The physicality of the game will shake loose your worries. But golf is much more solitary. Like baseball, it's you against the ball. And so being a mentally tough one-on-one player is incredibly important. Gerta was trying to shake Aurora's confidence.
Yeah, that is what I plan to do. To take the trophy from you. It will come home with me this year.
Aurora smiled.
We'll see. Who is your partner?
I am.
A woman with red hair stuck out her hand.
My name is Kathy. Kathy Elliott.
Aurora was taken aback.
I've seen you play here before. I thought you were a member.
I live on the course grounds, and I have many friends who are members, but I am not. So I am here today as Gerta's guest.
Kathy looked familiar to me, and I must have looked familiar to her because she stared at me a minute before saying,
You are the shop owner. That place that sells junk.
The urge to smack Kathy was so strong that my arm twitched. Luckily for me, Aurora noticed. She reached over and put a staying hand on my forearm.
If you mean the treasure chest, started Aurora, then you are right. Cara owns that adorable store. She's also my neighbor.
That took Kathy by surprise.
Neighbor?
I noticed that Kathy had chosen to talk past me instead of talking straight to me. Another attempt at making me feel insignificant. However, Aurora had left an opening for me to deliver a coup de grace.
That's right. I live next door to Aurora on Jupiter Island, I said.
Kathy's face flamed bright red. The median selling price of property on the island is $3.5 million. My house was a gift to Poppy by a grateful customer, and then Poppy rented it to me. But Kathy didn't need to know that. Instead, I only smiled at her in a slow but kind manner. That was my way of saying, got you. I'll give her this. Kathy recovered quickly.
Lucky you.
Aurora turned to say hello to Anita Collier and Tiffany Drummond, two more players who scrutinized me as if I'd crawled across the floor on my belly. These women were dressed like twinsies, both wearing red shirts and black, red, and white patterned skorts. I believe that was an homage to Tiger Woods, but I didn't ask. I'd had enough humiliation for one day.
Anita, you live here, and you're a member, right?
asked Aurora pleasantly. Yes, Tiffany belongs to Drifting Sands Golf Club. We have reciprocal privileges, you know. But I checked, and she's not considered a member. Like the flash of a light bulb, I understood the subtext. To get a strong partner, a few of these women had stretched the rules, defining a guest so far that they'd snapped. Kathy should have been a member, seeing as how she lived on the course grounds. But she wasn't. Tiffany should have been considered a member too, because of the reciprocal playing privileges. By skirting the rules, these teams had a member who was familiar with the course, and a guest who knew the course equally well. In other words,
we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.